way to AGQ Labs in Oxnard, California. It's an agro tech company, and they're going to show us all the incredible equipment that they have there. So it's exciting, and today is a great day.
Oh, and we'll show everybody else who's on the bus, so all the students. How neat. Right down to Dr. Herrera.
We look forward to this.
Hey,
hey,
good one.
Condors.
Get your cameo.
And we're arriving at AGQ headquarters.
AGQ has been around for about 20 years or so. The owner of the company's family is a potato farmer. And they were potato farmers. And the owner of the company, his name is Estanislao Martinez. He was studying agronomic chemistry at the university and looking at, you know, what's going on in the field, what's going on in terms of the soil underneath the plants. And his dad just started handing him sacks of fertilizer and saying, hey, I have this fertilizer that's telling me X percentage of these nutrients, and you test it to make sure I'm not getting screwed. And so he had a little makeshift in his garage, a little way to test, a little lab that he made. And started thinking about what can we do to actually do this better, growing. And he realized nutrients underneath the soil can tell you a lot about what's available for the plant. But they don't tell you the whole picture because plants, they don't eat their nutrients, they drink them through their roots. And he said, well, why don't I put something out there that can kind of tell me a little bit about what they're drinking? So they developed these lysimeters. They look like this, they stick it to the ground. There are suction probes, basically. We put these suction probes in the ground at different depths of the root profile, so some shorter, some longer, and we pull a vacuum in them that mimics the uptake rate of the roots, so it's kind of like pretend roots. And that way we can see the water that they're starting with, the water plus the fertilizer that they're applying in the field, we can see the nutrient levels move through the root profile, and we can tell what nutrients are actually being taken up by the plant. And in that way we can look at the plant foliar tissue, we can look at the soil chemistry that's going on underneath the plant and what's soluble there, and we can see kind of what the conditions of the field are. And we go out to the field and we help the growers interpret this data, especially in the context of the 20 years of consulting that we've been doing, because the plant needs change through the growth cycle. So we sample at every important phenological change and every important phenological stage. So when the plants are, you know, when they're budding, when they're fruiting, when they're flowering, all of these stages have different nutrient requirements or nutrient loads, and we try to make sure that the plant is getting everything it needs so that the client is putting everything he can or doing everything he can to get the best production and quality in the fruit or whatever he's growing, but also making sure that he's not applying too much nutrients into the field. A lot of people think a little bit is good, a lot is better. Not always the case. Like when you eat food, you know, you can make it too salty and then it's not so good. So when you apply nutrients too much in the field, what can happen is that they will actually move beyond the roots. They don't get taken up by the plant, and they leach into the water table. So then you have problems with nitrate leaching. So what we do is not just kind of help them get the best growth of their plant, but we really try to make sure we coach our clients to maintain sustainable practices out in the field, to make sure they're not having problems with reconcentrations of salts, which can affect the soil fertility later on down the line, and making sure that we're not having problems with contaminating the environment. And that's what we do in kind of the consulting side of the business. Here in this lab, we have two main lines of business. One is the one that I just explained, which we call nutritional monitoring. It's consulting service where we do the testing as well. And the other part of the laboratory is all related to pesticide residue testing. So we do a lot of import-export testing. What I like to say is that after they have their fruit or their product, we can test it to make sure it's safe to eat before it gets shipped out. Basically, anybody who's shipping to other countries product, whether it's citrus or berries or dried fruit or whatever it is, they have a need to make sure that they mitigate the risk in terms of trade blockages. So when you send a container of citrus to Japan, you want to make sure that the container of citrus that can be a high value product, or berries for example, that doesn't get stopped at the border and get rejected because it has a higher concentration of some pesticide that they don't allow in Japan, but they do allow here in the United States. So companies, especially ones that export to a lot of places, can be sending product to Europe where they have one set of legislation, to China or Hong Kong where they have different sets of legislation, or Taiwan or Japan, or to all kinds of places around the world. And the legislation is different in all those places. What they want to do is make sure that they test here in origin before they ship something to make sure they're compliant. The opposite is also true. Growers grow in Mexico, for example, or in South America, and they ship to the United States. And what they want to make sure before they ship the product is, am I complying with EPA? Here in the United States, EPA makes the rules for maximum residue limits about what pesticides, what residues are allowed. And FDA enforces them. So it's really, really normal for FDA to go out and spot check or test any product that's getting imported. And every once in a while, they find something that's not allowed or something that's a higher concentration than it's supposed to be, and they'll stop that. What happens is that product gets stopped at the border, and that importer then is blocked from importing anything else. So they have product in the field that can't get harvested. They have product that's perishable that's going to go bad in a couple of weeks. Containers that they can't move, and they have a big, big problem on their neck. We also help them get out of those situations and work directly with the FDA and sometimes the California Department of Pesticide Regulation, Residue, to find ways that they can move forward. So we interface with lots of different clients on the ag side, a lot of growers. On the food safety side, we interface with not just growers, but packing houses and a lot of certification bodies. And for the import-export that's related to the food safety, we interface directly with government organizations. So we really do a lot of a wide variety of things. In other countries, the company is in other sectors. So we work in the environmental sector, we work in microbiology, we work in GLP and laboratory practices, which is a special certification or accreditation for a registration of new phytosanitary products in Europe. So when someone has a new product that they want to apply in the field, before they can get it approved to apply, they have to petition the government to allow them to apply it. And in order to make that petition, they have to do all these studies of how the product degrades in the field at different climate conditions, etc. So, and we tell properties as well of the new products. So we do that. We have a couple of other special niches that we work in. In Chile, we do some testing for toys, for toluene contamination. Here in this lab, we also do antibiotics, tetracyclines, nitrofurans, colorants in fish and fish feed. So we work directly with the government of Costa Rica, or one of their official labs for testing this kind of thing. They have in Central America kind of a strong program for testing internal product before it gets shipped out, because they want to make sure that none of their industry is going to get in trouble in other countries because it creates trade problems. So we do kind of a wide variety of things here, but we do an even wider variety of things in our other labs. We have two labs in Spain, one in Morocco, one in Chile, one in Peru, a small one in Mexico that we're putting together, and this one here in the United States. And this lab has been here for about 3.5, almost 4 years, so it's a relatively new lab. So even though we have 7 labs, we're actually working in more than 20 countries, working in about 22 or 23 countries. So we consult millions of hectares, or acres, excuse me, like maybe 2 million acres over the world, and that's growing. Let me take you guys over to, I'll show you the kind of where samples come in, I'll show you where we do the sample preparation, and I'll show you where we look at the sample data on the instrument. Very, very important part of what we do in our everyday work. So even though the science is really cool and the testing that we're doing is really in some cases avant-garde, in some cases it's gold standard, in some cases it's really routine. It's really, really important in everything that we do because of the context of what we do that we control every part of that. So everything that walks into the laboratory, it needs to get logged into our system, it needs to have a tag. Because every once in a while you do have legal issues where you need to present data and you need to follow that chain of custody and follow the sample from beginning to end and know exactly where it is. So we have an internal system called the LIMS, the Laboratory Information Management System, that helps us track everything that walks into the lab. So operations and logistics, not only do they handle everything that leaves the laboratory and everything that comes in, which is not just from the United States, but we receive a lot of samples from Mexico, from Central America, from Costa Rica, from Colombia. And not only do they control that, but they also are kind of our first guard. They're the first filter to everything before it gets into the lab. So nothing passes through operations without us knowing exactly who it's from, without having a commercial person assigned to it, so a salesperson that generated a proposal for the client, without knowing exactly what it needs to be tested for, and without the laboratory saying, yes, okay, it's okay, we can take this sample. So everything comes in here. Some of the samples, they're barcoded, so we just scan them in. Some of the samples, they'll show up and we type them in into the system manually. They get tagged and they get passed to the laboratory. And the laboratory is organized from more manual work on this side to more automated work on the other side. Or if you want to think about it, more dirty work on this side to more clean work on this side. Here, for example, we're doing some texture analysis. So the drawers, I guess we come closer. Nothing's going to bite. So the growers in the field, a lot of times they want to know about the texture of their soil because it'll tell them about how long the nutrients are going to stick around. So if you have sand and you add a nutrient with your irrigation, that nutrient goes straight through. And if you have clay and you add a nutrient with irrigation, sometimes it can just immobilize and stick there, which for nutrients is not a bad thing, but if you apply an herbicide and it never goes away, it can be a really bad thing because you can become toxic. So this analysis, the texture analysis, is a really kind of physical analysis, physiochemical analysis, but it does give us important information that gives us a context for the rest of the data. Really what we're specialized here in is looking at the entire set of data and interpreting them based on the expertise that we have, the kind of knowledge of the reference values in the field and how all of the different factors interact with each other. We'll walk this way. The inorganic extraction group, we do any of the inorganic kind of digestions with acid that need to go in the hood, they get done in the hood, always here, safety's first, and any kind of soil extractions that we need to do for that agronomy side of things is all kind of done in here. There's a little bit of sample prep that we have next door, because when samples come in, we dry them and we homogenize them, which is basically just putting them in a blender or a soil crusher to make sure we have a homogeneous sample to test. In this lab, the organic extractions lab, what we do is all the pesticide residue extractions. So samples come in, if they're citrus, if they're strawberries, if they're leafy greens or spinach or beans or whatever it is that comes in, they'll come in here and we do the extraction. Extraction depends on what we're analyzing for. So sample prep is totally kind of defined by what parameters you're looking for. If you're looking at certain pesticides or herbicides, you may do one thing. If you're looking at another set of compounds, you may extract in a different way. We have here in the lab an automatic titrator, which we can do pH and electroconductivity. Those are really normal things to look at in the field. But we also can do any redox titrations there as well for oxidizable organic matter or active limestone, this kind of thing. We have a CFA unit. While you're here, I'll introduce you. This is Joseph Ziggy, he's the manager of the inorganic department, so he oversees all of the analyses that are related to the nutritional monitoring that we use. Jose Enrique is originally from Spain, and he relocated here to be with us. He's been 10 years with the company, so he's got a lot of experience here. This is Maria, she's the manager in the organic department, so she oversees all of the pesticide residue testing. Maria's been doing food safety testing for more than 10 years. She's with a lot of experience to us, and we've worked together for a long time. But we have a really, really close-knit team here. And one of the most important parts, wherever you guys go in the companies, is to know that the people you work with make all the difference. So it's even when the work is cool and you know the the pay may be fine or other situations. Really, the people that you work with and interact with on a day-to-day basis are really, really important. So always take that into mind when you're evaluating places where you're gonna be. This is a CFA unit, it's a continuous flow analysis. Even if you're not familiar with spectrophotometry, basically what we do, if you take a clear bottle of water and you shine light through it, most of the light's gonna come through, right? But if you take some juice and shine light through it, not all of the light is gonna come through, but some of it may come through. So what we do is we take advantage of these differences with specific chemistries in order to identify the parameters that we're looking at. So some molecules, say ammonia or urea, things that we're interested in measuring on the field, are interact with light in specific ways, at specific wavelengths. So what we do is we shine specific wavelengths through and see if they interact, and see if we get 100% of light on the back end or not. And that's what this machine does. It takes our sample, it splits it into four different channels. We go through four different reactions, chemistry reactions, and then we shine light through through the sample to see if we have any interactions. And that way we can identify if the compound's there. And say we're looking at alkalinity, we want to determine the alkalinity, or nitrates, or urea, or ammonia. And then we can quantitate, so we can see how much of it is in there. So that way we can tell the agronomy department exactly what's going on in the field, and they can figure out what they're gonna recommend to the client. And over here is the instrument room. It's a little bit louder, so I'm gonna yell a little bit when we get in, but you'll be able to see some cool stuff. Different types of instrumentation. So what you have behind me here, you may not be able to see it from the different angles, but if you get close, it's not gonna hurt you. If you look in there, kind of like when you look in the microwave, you'll see a light. Can you guys see it? Don't be scared, it's okay.
I see it.
You guys wanna see it? It's okay. Can you guys see it back there? Okay. Did you see it?
Okay. I see that I'm going to light.
This is a plasma. So it's not a flame. It's not actually like when you light paper on fire, which is just, that's like an oxidation reaction. A plasma, you can think of it as, you know, we have solids, so like ice, we have liquids, like the water that you drink, we have vapor, like steam. And then beyond that, there's another state of matter called plasma, which is really, really hot. So we take argon and we excite it until it's really, really hot, and it lights this color, basically. What's going on is this is a little chamber, and there's just lots of electrons in there, lots of energy flying around. What we do is we take our samples, which are in liquid form here, because they've already been digested or extracted, and we put them through a nebulizer, so we make them a very fine mist, like a spray. We put that spray into this chamber, and what happens is everything that's a complex molecule will first of all break apart because it's really, really hot, thousands of degrees Celsius. But beyond that, the molecule, the elements themselves, so the sodium, the potassium, the boron, they'll become excited. You guys did all like high school chem? Yes? Okay, so we have the nucleus of the atom, right? We have your proton and your neutron. And then outside you have your electrons, which are in a state, right? They have different shells, whether it's a P shell, the S shell, etc. So everything has a natural electronic state, which is the structure for where the electrons are. When you excite elements, what happens is that the electrons will pop into an outer shell, and they'll be in that excited form, but they don't want to stay there. they like being in their natural state. So what happens is they'll come into this chamber, they'll get excited with this energy, they'll bring in this energy, and then they come back down. And when they come back down, that energy goes somewhere. It leaves as light. And so what we see, it's kind of like when you're watching fireworks on 4th of July. You look up, something explodes, and you see red, and you go, as a chemist, you go, oh, it's phosphorus. You know, you see green, you go, oh, it's copper. You see orange or yellow, you see, oh, that's sodium, some sodium compound. So basically what we're doing here is the same thing that you're doing with your eyes on the 4th of July, except in a very controlled way, so that way we can monitor the wavelengths, the exact wavelengths that are being emitted. We can identify the elements and which serve as macronutrients and micronutrients out in the field, and then we can quantitate, so we can tell how much of them are there. So these are called ICP, inductively coupled plasma. OES is optical emission, which is emitting the light. Spectroscopy. Spectroscopy just means measuring light. So ICP is the how we generate the plasma, inductively coupled plasma, and the OES is just how we're measuring it. We have as well here in the lab, you'll see there's two instruments over here that are GCMSs, they're gas chromatographs, mass spectrometers. You have this one here, which is an LCMS, and that one, which is the same unit, it's an LCMS. So we have right now four, we're installing more mass spectrometers. Have any of you guys done it or been familiar with mass spectrometry? A little bit, okay. Yeah, there we go, so a couple. Perfect. What I'm going to do is when we move next door, I'll explain a little bit about what the mass spectrometer is. But basically, you can think of them as balances for the molecules. So we can put our extractions onto these instruments, and it'll tell us what the molecules weigh. And based on what the molecules weigh, we can identify them. In fact, I'll give you, if you give me 1 second. So we use these very thick columns. So these are gas chromatography columns. It looks like a wire. It's not a wire. It's actually hollow on the inside. And on the inside, it's coated with a really, really thin polymer coating. And what happens is that molecules interact with that polymer coating. And by the way they interact with that polymer coating, we're able to separate them out. I'll explain that a little bit next door. So that's the column for the gas chromatograph, and this column, these columns are the ones that we use for the liquid chromatography, and I'll explain the difference in this. We pass liquid through there. In there, inside there, instead of being a very, very thin film, what it is, it's actually, you can think of little balls of stationary phase. They're packed in there. Kind of like a powder. That's what I want. Imagine this liquid argon, and there's a space above it. What we do is we tap into the space above it, and we take that pressure off. So we feed the argon into the instrument. That way we can kind of conserve energy and make sure that we can fill up less amount of times, which means for us it's less logistics cost. But we can also make sure that we always have enough gas. We use a lot of it. So we do not just the science, but we also always have to deal with the very practical aspects of what's going on with us. We have a DI system, so we have some resin tanks over there that we treat our water with. In the lab, we're also in GigaWorks, we also have a MilliQ system, which will take water to the purest state that you can have it. So MilliQ water is at 18.2 megohms of resistance. You can't get much any cleaner than that. Interestingly enough, you guys ever have a chance to taste it? It tastes really great. So what makes your water taste good is actually the salts in the water. That's why the mineral water, that's why the stream, you know, like from rivers or from the ice packs, the water tastes good because it has salts and minerals in it. When you drink really, really pure water, it kind of feels like you're missing something.
It's not very good.
I think on Sunday, I've worked in research, you know, done like the publishing paper, which if any of you guys are interested in academia, it'll be important to get some experience and do research and publish. I've worked in government, so I worked at the Library of Congress in doing conservation science, which is kind of hard sciences applied to preservation of art and artifact. And at the Getty, actually underneath the museum, they have a whole floor of labs, which are really, really cool. We can chat another day if you guys want about that. Conservation science is a really cool sector. I worked in industry, so I worked in the environmental sector for a while, and I've worked now in food safety for quite a while. When I first spoke to the company about this project, they said, hey, we wanna do this, and we need somebody to help implement the methods and build the laboratory. I came to have a meeting. We had a meeting on a plastic table, like these, you know, the fold-out ones, kind of like that, and some plastic chairs with four or five people that were from the company. And they said, we're really interested in doing this. And the units next door, they looked like this. They were just concrete. So we've done everything in there, from putting in the floors, to changing the walls, to putting in the gases, instrument installs, method development, method implementation, every detail about what you have to buy, what the faucets have to look like, all of that stuff we've done next door. And we're gonna be doing it here to this space shortly, hopefully. So we'll be expanding this way. We have next door unit as well. We walk over there to where the break room is. We've just kind of taken everything over here and temporarily moved it while we figure out what we're gonna build. But all projects, whether they're large or small, but especially large projects, the only way to get stuff done is to break it up into smaller projects. So even though it seems like a world of difference from here to next door, it's a world of difference, but you separate out. First, do plumbing, electrical, gases, etc. And that way it makes it manageable. So even when you guys get busy in school and you have a bunch of billion things to do, you know, the way to make it manageable is if you're a list maker, make a list. If you organize yourself other ways, do that. But break it up into smaller projects. It helps a lot, so that way you can start crossing things off and not feeling like you're stuck. Because when you have projects that are this big and you don't have a way to measure it, you just feel like it's gonna crush you. So we'll go next door and we can sit and try. I did want to just follow up about the mass specs as we were talking about it. The chromatography part, when you hear GCMS or LCMS, it's gas chromatography, mass spectrometry, or LCMS is liquid chromatography, mass spectrometry. The chromatography part, chroma means color. It comes from, you guys ever color with washable markers? Mm-hmm. So if you have something like a paper or filter paper or whatever with washable markers and you put it in water, what happens though? They bleed, right? And they start separating into different colors. So that separation of the colors is where kind of this word comes from, chromatography. It's writing with color graph. Yeah? Even though the first example that we had was with color, really chromatography is the science of separation science. So what we do is we take all of those little vials that you guys saw. When we extract the pesticides, we end up with one solution, which is homogeneous. It's kind of like your orange juice in the morning. You drink it, and it's sweet, and it's tangy, and it's citrus, and it's all these things at once in your mouth. And you're like, oh, that's so good. But when we're analyzing stuff, we're like, ah, that's a lot of stuff to look at once. So what we want to do is we separate it. So the gas chromatography does that separation in those long columns that you guys saw, which could be 15 meters or 30 meters. They can get pretty long. And in the liquid chromatography side, we do the separation in these short packed columns that you guys saw. And instead of varying the kind of gas flow and the temperature, what we do is we vary the polarities in these kind of aqueous and organic phases. And the mass spec, it is just like I told you guys, it's a balance for molecules, so we can put in a molecule. But this is actually a really special type of mass spec. It's called triple quadrupole mass spectrometry. And what we do is, if you imagine kind of running down a hallway, the first thing that we do is we bombard the molecules with electrons to make sure they're charged, maybe like an electron gun, and you pass through them. And then once all the particles that can be are charged, they run through this long hallway. Imagine if all of us ran through the same corridor, more or less at the same speed. This is kind of in a vacuum. And I said, I only want to filter out for your weight, right? How much do you weigh? Don't be embarrassed. 160. Is there anybody else that weighs roughly 160? Okay, so there's a couple of people. All right, so if we all ran through a hallway, and I said, I want to filter only 160, so I want to filter out everything else, we can actually stabilize the environment so the 160, mass 160 only gets through. But in this case, we would have more than one person. There are different individuals coming through there. It wouldn't be just one thing. So what we do is then we take those molecules and we crash them into argon and we break them up. And from the way they break up, we can tell. It's kind of like a fingerprint. We can back calculate where they came from because we can look at the parent mass and the daughter masses. And even though there are more people that weigh 160 here, not everybody has the same size head. Not everybody has the same size arm or leg or shoe size, you know, their feet. And so we can see from the starting mass, we filter out, then we crash them and break them up, then we can see the daughter masses, and we can be very specific about the daughter mass to the parent mass ratio and the retention time, how long it took to get through the column. And all of that information, the sum of all of that information allows us to be able to tell, hey, we're looking at 350 different pesticides here, herbicides, fungicides, etc., insecticides. What's in the sample and how much is in it? So you've heard me say that several times. So the identification and the quantitation. And that's kind of the mass spec, so you guys now know. Next time you're here, I'm gonna quiz you about the instruments. This is Henny. Henny's in our QA department. And you guys met Maria, who's phenomenal. Cynthia is also phenomenal. And Antonio, he's really, really awesome too. And this is Henny, she's like one of my right-hand people. She's in the QA department. I'll let her tell you guys about herself a little bit.
Okay. I don't want to bore you with my story for too long, but just some. Well, all of you are in college, right? Community college?
No, I'm just
starting community college. Well, you've gone through the high school process, so I'm not going to go into that. But is there anything specific you guys would like to hear from me?
Maybe you could tell what your quality control, what you do, because a lot of our students don't know what QA stands for. What it means.
Quality assurance. Well, I have multiple responsibilities in the department at the lab. I'm in charge of following startup protocol for our accreditation. So we have rules to follow to keep our certificate of accreditation for the lab. There's a lot of document control. There's a lot of instrument maintenance records that we have to keep on file. Assisting customers with questions or problems that they have with the sample that they sent to analyze here in the lab. What else? Working with the lab to compile results to validate our methods. So every analysis that we do has to be validated to comply with our accreditation. And now that the lab has to compile, analyze, validate the data, and then have to compile it. Put it into an Excel sheet and make sure that we're meeting all of our standards. It's a very fun, interesting job that I have. I get to learn something new every day, and that's something important for me to keep me motivated and keep me going.
What's your college pathway that you took?
College pathway. Well, I've always been, I've been good at following rules. So throughout high school, I would do my homeworks. Doing the homeworks would help me learn the material, and I would do well in tests. So that was my college pathway. I was very curious. That was sort of like my motivation of doing well in school. College was not something I planned for. they just came across. I would have a 4.0 in high school, but I never persuaded the possibility of going to college. Both of my parents didn't reach or go above third grade level. So that was nothing within my grasp. College was definitely not an option for me. Until I had a college counselor that saw my grades and told me, hey, you should go to college. And I had, like I said, college was not for me. Even though I had grades, I was good at following rules. So he put me in contact with some college people. I applied to colleges, I accepted to colleges. Berkeley was one of the colleges I was accepted to, and they have this program where they fly you up north to visit the college, and I decided to go and visit Berkeley. And I like Berkeley, so I just took a chance and accepted Berkeley and decided to go to Berkeley. But like I said, college was definitely something I wasn't working for, I planned for. It just sort of happened to come across my path.
What did you study at Berkeley when you were there?
Berkeley. I didn't know what to apply for when I applied for colleges. So my counselor saw my grades. He said, oh, you're good at math, you're good at science. You should be a chemical engineer.
Wow.
So I'm like, okay. I tried chemical engineering and applied to colleges. I got accepted. I went in my first year, I struggled a lot. It was hard. College is hard. It's very, very competitive. You're competing against the top 10% or students that are in the top 10% of the class. So I enjoyed math. I definitely didn't enjoy physics. And I enjoy the most organic chemistry. So chemical engineering, the way I saw it, was a lot of physics and math. So it was definitely not something I was gonna enjoy doing. So I looked into other careers and found chemical biology, which contained a lot more organic chemistry. And that's how I ended up. I started with chemical engineering and I ended up with chemical biology. But I found that out as I started taking courses. Yes?
You mentioned you follow a lot of certifications. Are you guys ISO 9000?
17025.
So you're in charge of those certifications?
Yes.
We do 9000 in some of our other labs, like in our headquarters in Europe. So all of our labs are base level 17025 accredited, which is like an international accreditation for labs. And then based on the needs of each lab or the requests of the clients or what we need to adapt to the market in that country or in the country we're serving in that lab, then we go out and pursue different certifications or accreditations. So here in the United States, that would be things like ELAP, which is something just only for the United States, or FAST, which has to do with aflatoxin testing, which is only here for the United States. But here we're an approved lab for testing for Japan, because we have a lot of people that export to Japan. We're approved, we've been audited by the country of Costa Rica, their laboratories to do import-export analysis for them. And in some of our other labs, we have some of the documentation, like the 9000 series. In Europe, we're also GLP certified, so there's a bunch of stuff. Here, definitely 17025 and some other things.
Thank you.
How long did it take you to get your business up and running in the city? Maybe you can tell them a little bit about that.
About getting the business up and running. We have a very, very special situation here where AGQ USA is very much like a startup in many ways. It started with like five people. you know, somebody that was really good at sales, somebody that's really good at the technical side of the agronomy, the consulting, somebody that was really good in the lab, a finance guy, and the owner of the company who came to make sure that it was going to get off the ground correctly. So in that sense, it's been really cool because it's been, you know, going from 4 or 5 people to 45 in a company in less than 4 years, which is growth that you're not used to seeing in any company anymore. So it's a special situation because it's very much like a startup, but in many ways it's not. We have a lot of assurances that startups don't. So we didn't go through any of the kind of biotech funding. We didn't have to deal with angel investors or VC, venture capital, or anything like that. Though I do have friends in the biotech industry, and I see that happening. We didn't have to live that because we had a parent company that actually was handling all of the finances for us. So they decided that United States, this laboratory was a really great place to serve our clients in Mexico, Central America, and expand our client base in the United States. And they said, we're gonna make that investment and we're gonna put down millions of dollars to build this lab. And they essentially handed over you know, some cash and a list of things that they wanted. And our job was to make sure we did that and deliver. And we've been trying to deliver. The experience of getting it off the ground. I think the biggest thing I could say is what I was saying next door, which is lots of stuff in life looks like it's gonna crush you and it looks giant and it's huge and complex. Sometimes you think, oh, college, that's 4 years, that's how many units, that's how many classes, and it sounds like a lot of stuff. If you break things down to smaller projects, you can start crossing things off the list and then you can see your own progress. So if you break things down into smaller manageable chunks, then things start happening. So a lot of stuff, but if you make it manageable, then it's okay.
If you had your choice and you can go back to when you just got started, could you envision going to work for a company and just showing up every day to do a job versus what you've been involved with in getting a startup? I know all the problems with a startup, but how do you feel as the accomplishments start happening?
I think for me, life has always been in phases. So this I see as a phase in my life that has been really, and is really beautiful and challenging and growth promoting. I think we all make decisions. I made a decision here to come into the company, but so did everybody else on the team. So Antonio, who came from Spain, Jose Enrique, that came from Spain, Maria, that I brought from my network, but that came from, she was living in Central Coast, Venice from Spain, Penny was here local, she was looking at different things. In fact, Penny was working in our lab. We passed her from the lab to QA. We have Abraham, who was working in the lab as a tech, who was then giving some projects, and now he works in our sales department. So everybody has kind of made a decision to be here. One of the coolest things is that everybody who's here wants to be here. Can I envision what it would be like? My personality is a personality that doesn't rest. So I think regardless of where I would be, or regardless of where I find myself, I try to make the best of it and ensure that I'm always growing. So I always reevaluate those 4 things that I was talking about on Sunday. Is, am I good at this? Do I like this? Is this sustaining, you know, I mean, is this sustaining the lifestyle that I want? And can I find some way to give back? So if I weren't giving back to the environment, to the community, to our growing client base, I'm sure I'd be doing things that, you know, like I used to, you know, volunteer. I went to, after Hurricane Katrina, to New Orleans. I went to Honduras to go build latrines. I went to Chile on a volunteer trip. I grew up in a family where it was inculcated into us that was an important value to have. So my mom always took us to go feed the homeless, to go do stuff on holidays. You know, even though it was her and 3 kids, I don't know how, you know, a single mom with 3 kids can decide to do that, just do it on a regular basis. But I'm sure I would find ways that would make whatever position or whatever job I am someplace where I'm learning and growing. And if not, I would just move on.
Can you talk about if let's say I walked in your door as a graduating from college, do you put them with a lab, do you put them with a person, or do you send them to training? Talk about how a person gets acclimated into your business.
Yeah, so we've taken a couple of approaches here at AGQ. When we first started hiring people, the immediate labor market didn't exactly match what I needed, so I wanted people that fit within our budget, that could grow with the company. And I wanted people, if they had experience, that were specific to what we're doing here. What we're doing here is really, really specific, and beyond that, it's the set of what we're doing, that is this plus this plus this, you don't find many other places. So I realized quickly that 4 years ago, for the positions we were trying to fill, I found people that were either overqualified or underqualified. There's people that had graduated high school that had zero to no training, and there was people that were master's degrees that were applying, people that were in industry for 4 or 5, 6 years. And I said, I need to find a way to bring bright individuals onto the team that can grow with the company. So we kind of devised a training program that was a way to provide stepping stones for a recent grad to get to having experience in the lab. So we made an investment with several people, which was, I'm going to train you, it's going to take you 2 years to really be independent, learn how to take apart the instrumentation, put it back together, do troubleshooting, be an analyst and be able to work on your own and make the decisions that you need to make as someone that's been working in labs 2 or 3 years. I'll train you better than probably wherever else you'll go, because nowhere's going to really teach you to take apart the instruments and think for yourself, but it's important for our lab to have depth of knowledge so that people really, really understand the limits of the instrumentation. But for that, I need you to stay with me, and I need to have a commitment for you to stay on long term. That has worked by and large for us in those positions that we really need to fill, but we're continually tweaking and trying to figure out what's the right equation. How do we gauge? How do we design our hiring processes? How do we look for candidates as they're coming up? How do we build relationships? So we have some candidates too that are from community colleges that were here working part-time or full-time, and they have transferred out, and then they've come back this summer to work. And I hope that those are individuals that later on decide, hey, ag is growing, food industry is growing, this is a sector to be in, it's only going to get more important, we're going to become very overpopulated relatively quickly, and even though the problem we have now is a distribution problem, we don't get the food where it needs to go, the problem in several years is going to be a supply problem, where we don't make enough food that people can eat. And this question is only becoming more important, so food safety and food security, whether we can have the food that we need, and whether it's going to make us sick when we eat it, are things that are paramount to not just us, but the global community. If there are individuals that later in their academic studies and their careers say, hey, this is actually a sector I want to be in, and this was a really cool place to work, that then later on, there'll be people that we can bring on. So we're always trying to kind of tweak and find the right equation. So that changes from time to time, the positions we're looking for, what we do. But definitely a big component of that is on the job training. Is whether they're technicians or whether they're analysts, they're it's on the job training. One of the things I do want to point out, and I'm really glad that when I look at the group, it's a diverse group. There are a lot of gals here. When we walk through the lab, if you notice, there's a lot of girls in the lab too. So don't be discouraged. It's really, there are positions, and Penny's a perfect example. She's here locally. She went to Berkeley, which is one of the best schools we have in California. Which, by the way, in California, are some of the best schools in the nation. So it's one of the best schools in the nation, Cal. And she's here in a position which probably 5 years ago she didn't know existed. Right? I didn't know before I came here that this position existed. So I was talking about before, that I studied things that I was interested in. Somehow they came together. That may not be the case for everybody, but again, reevaluate and look at those 4 things.
Would you share with us how much time and effort went into you succeeding in school, and how much time and effort goes into your work today to make it successful? And that's for you, Penny, and
you want to start, Penny?
Okay. Okay, so regarding school, I mean, after I graduated in the University of Spain, I studied economics, and after I finished my career, my university degree, I started working as an accountant. That's how I began my career as a finance person. And after 12, 15 years of experience, I had the opportunity to come here to California. And I was involved in this project, this amazing project of building and making grow a lab in the United States, in California. And it's been a very hard time, but I think that everybody here is really, really happy, people that is working here. But in the management level, I think that it's been really, really hard with many, many hours. And I mean, I think that I used to work like Jesse, I don't know, like 11, 12, 13 hours a day. We are always connected. We never disconnect. We try to. But I mean, I think that we are so happy with the project and what we are doing here that, I mean, we can manage all that time that we are not spending with our family or with to have some fun or some rest. But yeah, that's I mean, it has a price to work in a project like this, but as far as it gives you happiness, I think that that's what it makes you to continue working so hard. So that's my experience.
And you're also working on different time zones too, right?
Yeah, yes. We are managing Central America, Mexico, Colombia. Headquarters is in Spain. So, I mean, at night when we are having dinner, we are receiving emails from Spain. It's 9 hours different. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn how to deal with that. But, I mean, it's, as I told before, it's, if you are happy doing that, you can continue. I think that at the moment that you are not happy anymore, it's when you say, okay, guys, I'm leaving to the beach. So, but that's not the moment by now.
Okay, hi. Well, I went to college right after high school in 2009. I graduated high school 2009. So I'm so far, well, you know, 2009. I went in the first year, I took some time off to work. Got like some money to pay for college because I paid my way through college. Went back in 2011. So there was a gap in between my college career, but I managed to finish in 5 years. And then December 2010, that's when I graduated. I looked for jobs. It's hard. It was hard during that time to look for a job that I wanted. Before I graduated, I did some research in biofuels, learning how to sort of manipulate grass, the tall grass, and make it into a fuel that can be used instead of gasoline. So I wanted a job in that field. I applied, there's a company nearby that works in that, so I wanted to apply there, but they were only taking individuals with you could say more experience and more years in the industry. So it was hard for me to find a job in that field. So I decided to look into other fields, something that's going to be friendly, environmental friendly, and I found AGQ. And that's how I came across. But total 5 years, and then getting the job, that was 2013, I believe. So 3 years, I got the right job.
Yeah, in terms of the hours and effort, all of this lots. Like I mentioned on Sunday, I've been working full time for a long time, and I worked full time when I was going through college, and I was perpetually sleep deprived. And now I try to find a better balance because sleep is really important. If I can recommend anything, sleep is really, really, really. We can talk about the science of sleep and whatever you guys want, but make sure you sleep. That's actually pretty critical for your health. Yeah, I mean, I studied at Pepperdine, and in 4 years, I double majored and into a certificate program. And then after that, I was already working in different the sciences, but in different sectors. And starting a company, the effort, I think that there are a lot of parallels between having a job that you're really passionate about and if you're studying, being passionate about studying. Because if you're studying and you really enjoy learning, you end up doing, you just spend a lot of time doing it. And if you're doing work that you really like doing, you really spend a lot of time doing it. But part of that is because you have to spend those hours doing it. But part of that is kind of because you just voluntarily, want to make things better. And I think that's part of the reason why people who are doing things that they love or enjoy are particularly successful on average. Yeah.
Students, do you have any questions? Are you impressed?
Thank you.